that's amen.
Amen.
All right, let's read it together. 1, 2, 3, read. Amen. And he cometh unto the disciples, and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, what? Could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. The word of the Lord is blessed. There's a lot to the story, and I won't delve into the details of it this morning. But let me just paint a quick picture for you, and then maybe you'll understand where I'm going, where we need to go together. There were 11 disciples left after Judas betrayed Jesus. Judas decided he was going to betray Jesus. They were all together at this supper just a few hours before Judas left. There was 11 disciples that remained. Of the 11, Jesus took his inner circle, which was Peter, James, and John, the three men who were closest to him. And we'll learn about why they were closest to him. But these three gentlemen who were the closest to him, he took them with him deep into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. And while Jesus was pouring his heart out to his Father, guess what these three men did? They fell asleep. We're at a prayer meeting with Jesus. All of us should be praying because we love God. But these three individuals fell asleep. Now, isn't that terrible? But it's not so terrible that you haven't done it. How many of us have fallen asleep during the prayer meeting? How many of us just fall asleep in church? Come on, tell the truth. Matter of fact, let me scan the room right now. Fall asleep? And I don't know about you, but whenever I fall asleep and I shouldn't be asleep, it's embarrassing to me. You know, like at a meeting or in class, and somebody got to wake you up because you're snoring to yourself. Is that embarrassing? That's embarrassing to me. I don't know about you. It's embarrassing to me. Especially when you're doing one of these numbers. And God forbid if you're doing one of these numbers. There was a preacher used to attend this church many, many years ago. Some of you know him. I won't call his name. Some of y'all know him. And every Sunday. Did I say every Sunday? Every Sunday. Now, am I exaggerating? Some of you have to exaggerate. I am not exaggerating. Every Sunday, he'd sit in that seat, and see, one problem that he had was he always would slouch. He never would sit up. If you sit up, you have a better shot at trying to stay awake, but he would get comfortable. And he was already kind of a, you know, and we all look at him, especially all the young people, Sunday night, and he had a problem. He had sleep apnea. You know, he fall asleep. He just had a problem. But one day he was preaching on a Sunday night. I don't know if people forget this. And he talked about people who fall asleep in church. Now that was it right there. We look at these disciples, we look at the preacher that I was just talking about, who I didn't call his name, but Deacon Cranford did. And there's automatically a criticism that envelops in our spirit that we want to unleash. And we fail to identify the humanity that's in all of us. There's a human side. To every story that you read in the Bible, there's a human side. To every story that we live as Christians, there is a human side. That's the side that we need to dig up. That's the side that we need to expose. That's the side that we need to talk about, because the Spirit is willing. But the human side, the flesh, is what? And one thing about it, dear hearts, one thing about it, you are not going to be able to release your humanity until you die. You got to drag your human side with you everywhere you go. You know how we used to sing that song about higher, Lord, take me higher? The higher you go, the more you got to take your human side with you. Because I don't care how high you get, you're still human. I don't care how spiritual you get, you're still human. No matter what position you attain in church, no matter how anointed you become, when the anointing lifts, when the benediction is said, I'm still. And there are a couple of you in here right now that don't think, I mean, you know, but you don't think that I'm human. You know that I am, but you don't think that I am. There was something going on a couple weeks ago. Lord Jesus. There was something going on a couple of weeks ago. Oh, I know what was going on. Something was happening with the mics. Chuck needed to get in this room, but he didn't have a key. Everybody with a key was somewhere else. Did you feel me?
Yes, sir.
Chuck, I can't get it. The mic is messing up. He can't get in the room. I'm looking around for somebody with a key, and nobody with a key is in the sanctuary. So I went out there, and I let loose. I was right about it. Anybody in here? I invite you to read the story. I invite you to read the story. Read the story of Jesus in the 26th chapter of Matthew. It's a long chapter, but it's a good chapter. I want you to identify the humanity of Jesus Christ. Yes, Jesus Christ, when he was on this earth, was human. He was both human and divine. Now watch this. Jesus, once he knew who he was. Now, why do I say that? He didn't always know who he was, because when he was a baby, he didn't know anything. But it was revealed to him who he was as he grew. I'm the Son of God. And he knew what his purpose was. What was his purpose? His purpose was to die. His purpose wasn't to heal. His purpose wasn't to raise the dead. That wasn't his purpose. His purpose wasn't to open the blind eyes. He did all of those things. But his purpose was to die. And he knew it. Didn't he know it? He would tell the disciples, I'm going to be crucified. He let them know, I'm going to die. But look at his humanity in the garden. Now, I'm going to paraphrase for you. Because in the scriptures it says, Jesus said, Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. You see that? Said another one, oh my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me, nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. Yeah. You know what he was saying? He was saying, Daddy, I don't want to do this. See, the King James kind of flowers it up for you. Uh-huh. But when you really boil it down and really try to get into what he was saying, he was saying, Dad, I don't want to do this. I know I was born to do this, but I really don't want to do this.
My God.
That was his, what, his. Aren't there times when you don't want to do?
Yes, sir.
What?
Amen.
Ain't nobody human but me. Isn't there times when if you could talk God out of something, you would?
Yes. Lord, yes, God.
Yes.
Lord. Thinking about it, and I think I got a better plan. He was saying, Dad, I know I'm supposed to die, I know I'm supposed to, but I really don't want to do it. But thank God for the blood.
Yes.
But what I want to focus on is that first statement, because many of us, we miss it.
Yeah.
And we feel bad because we feel weak. We think we're not supposed to feel weak. That there's something wrong. I must have, maybe I didn't pray enough because I feel weak.
Yeah.
I said, no, I think it might have been Friday. Man, I'm not going to church tonight. And she had never heard that from me. She said, huh? I said, you're going out there, I'm not going. And she said, boy, you better come on here. And then I just went, why I gotta go all the time? And she said so sweetly and so smartly and so directly and just came out with it quick, cause you the pastor. Now the storm was raging. Come on now. The storm. nobody do. You mothers know about this. Yes. Can't nobody find certain things but you.
Yes.
So they, mama, and wake you up and get you up and you go and you have sleep, but you go right where it is. Get mad, and then what you do?
Go back to sleep.
Back to bed. Yeah. Amen.
I like to think that Jesus kind of did the same thing. Yeah. Peace be still, other word. Come on, man, rain. Stop all that.
Yeah. Let's be a blessing to the Lord. Amen. Be a blessing to the Lord.